And welcome to this special Ebola edition, which I originally was not going to do, but I was prompted to, and then finally decided to after the Journal of American Medical Association published an article on avoiding compassionate use. Now, we're going to get to the treatments and nutritional therapies, potential nutritional therapies, a little bit down the line. But let's cover this first article, which really got me going, in regards to avoiding compassionate use. Now, I understand the article from a scientific premise, but let's read it, and then you decide whether this is ethically acceptable or not. All right, we look at the Journal of American Medical Association, obviously recently published here, October 1st, 2014, and I want to read you one segment out of this article. Allowing consideration of rescue rather than scientific hypothesis to drive the use of novel agents, we'll eliminate that word, however, because it reads a little easier, risks compromising the acquisition of knowledge needed to clarify their role in the next epidemic and ultimately to maximize benefit for patients. So let's read that once again. Allowing considerations of rescue rather than scientific hypothesis to drive use of novel agents, risk compromising the acquisition of knowledge needed to clarify the role in the next epidemic and ultimately to maximize benefits of patients. Not your patient at the time, but patients maybe somewhere down in the future. So, stop trying to grab at straws and do exactly what they tell you to do so you can maintain everything in a proper clinical setting, and if people die, well, it's in the benefit of future patients. If that's the way it's being read, then some of us may have a problem with that. But you decide. All right, let's move forward to the potential treatments, which may have to be avoided because of compassionate use. I mean, they haven't been tested enough in humans enough to make sure they work, but what the heck, let's save some lives in the meantime. From the Annals of Internal Medicine, you may have heard something called serotherapy. Serotherapy is a serum therapy. It's kind of like, not the same as antibody, but what happened was they take the blood of animals or humans that had survived a certain type of disease or ailment and then inject certain parts of that blood into the individual who's currently affected. And this is what happened. Now, you may remember Kent Brantley and Nancy Reipal. This is their journey. Brantley, moribund and poorly responsive, we're talking about the doctor first, to previous blood transfusions containing convalescent antibodies, those being your standard industrial treatments, apparently began to recover within an hour after receiving the medication. And was able to take a shower on his own before getting on a plane and flying to the United States. That was published on the 12th of August, 2014. That was serotherapy. Serotherapy, go into a little bit more detail, nice little article from the digital world here on anti-serum and Ebola virus. It's nothing really new. It's been around since from the 1870s to the 1890s. They use anti-serums for snake bite, hepatitis exposure, protect people from tetanus. And again, it's needed when immediate protection is needed. Anti-serum can act very quickly. So again, it's nothing new that hasn't been used before in humans. And also, too, as far as being tested in humans, when they used anti-serum or hyperimmune serum for basically people with Ebola virus, they find that with the animals, they obviously elicited the best immune response, goats, horses, you name it. But when volunteers, being humans, in clinical trials for biological safety and reactivity, they were administered to researchers suspected of becoming infected with EPO during the experiment work. These immunoglobulins may be useful for the emergency treatment of persons accidentally infected with EPO. So it has already been tested safely in preclinicals. So that's your serum therapy. And that's what may have cured the two first individuals that were made aware of in the media from Ebola. Now, keep in mind, they were also later on given something called ZMAP. ZMAP manufactured by MAP Pharmaceuticals. So if we look at this, and what originally before it was called ZMAP, it was known as MB-003, which is not unusual to have for experimental drugs waiting for patent to have these weird names. And so what happened was they were developing this through the U.S. Army Medical Research Institute, and they were able to give ZMapp effectively to monkeys. Remember, humans and monkeys are different, and cure them within 48 hours. Again, MB-003, manufactured by MAPP Pharmaceuticals. Now, the reason I bring up this research article is this. Now, something happened because the ZMapp or MB-003, which is originally being promoted here, somehow, just give you the full article, is now hard to produce. So the but however, in the article here, antibody is produced in the baclofen system. Dot 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 dot. Manager. Large amounts of quantity of the antibody easily, and they said our GMP facility can generate a new antibody lot in 2 weeks to rapidly address new threats and new outbreaks. So, if let's say, for example, disease has some sort of genetic variant or drifts, so to say, they can adapt to it very, very readily. And again, funded by the U.S. military, Department of Defense, and the whole National Institute of Health, and all of a sudden now, it's difficult to get a hold of. But to confirm it again in human trials, let's look at it this way. All right, post-exposure antibody treatment protects primates from Ebola and the Marburg viruses. The reason I brought up Marburg, because it weaponized forms there. I'll get to it in a little bit. All the monkeys generated an immune response to Marburg virus and survived subsequent rechallenge with the virus. Again, the ZMapp or MB-003 seemed to be very effective and potentially very effective when combined with serotherapy. Because again, they both got both therapies, they both received both therapies at that time. So ZMapp and serotherapy seem to be your two prominent treatments out there that, at least in animals, are very effective, in some human cases, extremely effective. Now let's look at the nutritional aspects. Now this part I have a problem with because the doctor, when he mentioned a lot of you hear people on the news say melatonin cures Ebola. The doctor, when he mentioned melatonin, was saying it because it worked well with septic shock, and it needs to be basically researched in regards to Ebola, not curing Ebola. Because anything that attempts to help with the vascular system maintain its integrity seems to be very effective. So he just said, hey, it's a potential use as a treatment, not as a cure, but so, however, maybe some very well-meaning people out there started saying melatonin's a cure, and it's not. It's an abstract, and I've seen this abstract mentioned. The abstract doesn't mention any treatments, current treatments with melatonin. It just said it's something that needs to be looked at. And I feel bad for this guy because all he said was, hey, check out melatonin, let's see if it works. And now everyone's saying, oh, look, the guy said melatonin cures Ebola. No, it may help, but it needs to be studied. Next one. This one came out of China. And obviously, for good reason. You'll discover why in a bit. Science China came out and looked at a few other things to maintaining vascular integrity in regards to Ebola. They looked at rutin or vitamin P, remember to maintain the vascular integrity so you don't hemorrhage. They also looked at vitamin C. Yes, and I saw vitamin C saying it cures Ebola. No, they were just looking at it to see if it could help in adjunctive treatment. They also looked at methylprednisone as far as maintaining vascular integrity. So, yes, they are looking at things, anything that could potentially help with the treatments or adjunct to Ebola, but it needs to be at least studied in animals before we can even make a decent hypothesis. So, if you're stuck in a desert island, you got nothing available, yeah, grab it. It may be a good tool. But in the meantime, don't mislead people who may have been exposed in not getting potentially good treatment because serotherapy or basically ZMapp or MB-003 looks like it has a strong promise of saving lives. Melatonin, vitamin C, P, and rutin, they look cool, but we haven't even begun to study them yet in animals. Now we go on to the next subject. Now, this form of Ebola that came in was caught people a lot off guard. Now, did you realize in the 1980s that this item was weaponized? And how the Russians, or I should say Soviets at that time, had missiles pointed at the United States with weaponized Ebola. Prior in response to our development of the neutron bomb, we both wanted to be able to destroy populations but keep the cities and industry intact. Sick mentalities we had back then, it really hasn't changed that much. So, Ebola virus could actually, at their time, to give you an idea, they were able to inject into the vaccine a virus. So you can inject a virus into a virus, which they said couldn't be done, but yet was. And that's, of course, part of the smallpox virus thing, which we happily vaccinated our U.S. troops against smallpox. But however, though, you better watch out, because the vaccine a virus is used to make vaccines itself. Not saying anything, you can grab the conjecture from there. And also, too, accidental release. And the reason I'm bringing it up, because a lot of terrorists would like to be able to use Ebola, but I'm not going to go into much detail past that point because it would not be responsible. But let's look at an accidental release. And just to give you an idea, because we're not perfect. No one's perfect. Let's look at what happened in China. All right, back in 1999, intelligence agents came forward and they found evidence that two epidemics of hemorrhagic fevers, it could be Marburg, it could be Ebola, swept the region in the late 1980s. The area had never known such a disease before, which caused profuse bleeding and death. Henceforth, we head back to, we head back to vitamin P, vitamin C, and methylprednisone because you're trying to stop the bleeding. And of course, that was research was done in China at the same time. What a surprise. Our analysts concluded that they were caused by an accident in a lab where Chinese scientists were weaponizing viral diseases. Viral scourges that cause intense bleeding include Marburg fever and the dreaded Ebola virus. Both are endemic to Africa. The point I'm getting at is the fact is we're still messing around with a lot of these diseases because we're fascinated with trying to find efficient ways of taking people out, but we're not exactly the safest with them. So even our CDC has had case reports of releasing biotoxins by accident. And obviously the same thing happens in the Russia and China. So you have to take into account when you have something like this that spreads and you have this massive genetic drift that potentially someone could have been screwing around. Not being conspiratorial, but you got to look at all aspects when you want to try to save lives. Don't just bury your head in the sand and say, hey, we live in a perfect world and these things can't happen. And again, that's it. Brief run through. Thank you, Jama, for saying avoid compassionate use in regards to a lot of these medicines, because that prompted me to do this. And any questions, feel free to email. Again, this is speculative, hypothetical. And when it comes to nutrients, at a long shot, you can say hypothetical. Until then, all you can really say is, I don't want anything to say a good guess, because that's pretty much the same as hypothetical. Again, Ralph Turchiano signing off, and thank you very much once again.